Good morning. Want to welcome you to Haven Heights this morning. If you're visiting with us, want to especially welcome you. Want to wish Pastor Lance a happy birthday. I'm sure he's listening online, so keep his family in your prayers as they've had some sickness. A few other announcements here. So our Pastor Appreciation Fellowship meal has been postponed until next Sunday, November 6th, after the morning service, and all are invited to attend. And on that note, there was a few food items brought in today, so make sure you get back to the kitchen and take a little bowl home, and hopefully maybe Pat and Carlene could take some to pastor in them. Let's see here. Next Sunday, during the Sunday school hour, we will have a question and answer time with Pastor Landon Schaffner at 9:30. So this will take place in the sanctuary. Questions can be asked from the floor, or if you'd feel more comfortable to email them to Pastor Lance, you know, they can be answered that way. And next Saturday morning will be the next men's fellowship at 7:30 in the morning. Our next members meeting is coming up November 13th. I believe that's all for the announcements. So at this time, we will prepare our hearts for worship. Our call to worship comes from the book of Romans, chapter 5, verse 1. Therefore, since we have been justified through faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. The word of the Lord. If you would, please stand with me as we sing our hymns.
Crown him with many crowns.
Thank you.
Seated. This time Pastor Landon will come.
Well, good morning. Let us go before the Lord in prayer this morning. Our Father, we thank you that we now have peace with you through the finished work of Christ. For Lord, our sins are many. We confess those sins before you. Father, we confess that we have sinned before you in our thoughts, not thinking thoughts after you. We confess that we have sinned with our words, not speaking that which brings you glory, not building up our brothers and sisters who also bear your image, but tearing others down. Lord, we have spoken hatred. We have spoken vile things with our mouths. Father, we confess that we have sinned against you in the things that we have done. Lord, wicked things. And yet we thank you that where our sin was many, much, your mercy was more. We thank you that in Christ you have put away each and every one of those sins, that we have now been reconciled to you in peace. Father, we pray that you would stir our hearts this morning to worship you as those who have been brought to peace with you. And Father, we just want to pray that the gospel, this good news that you have put away our sin, would go forth here from this church and from also other churches in this area. We pray specifically for our tithes and our offerings. Lord, we know that this money, these things we give to you are yours. We are mere stewards of them. And so, Father, we joyfully give them to you to do with as you please. And we pray that you would use even these feeble things we give to further advance your gospel to the ends of the earth. Father, we also think of those this morning who are enduring pain or suffering or sickness in some way. We think of Pastor Lance and his family. We just ask that you would bring them healing that they have waited for so long. We pray that you would grant them peace as they await this healing? Would you draw near to them as they undergo this sickness? Lord, we pray for Annabelle Smith and her surgery. And Father, even as she experiences this pain, would you draw near to her in her pain? We pray that you would give her a soft heart, and that even in the pain, she would experience more love to you, O Christ. And Lord, we bring all our other pains to you this morning. Lord, you know our hearts and our lives better than even we do. And so we pray, would you strengthen us and give us faith to pursue you and love you and trust you even in the face of these things. Help us this morning, Lord, to worship you with glad hearts as those who have been forgiven from our sin. We pray all this in the name of Christ. Amen.
Good to see you all. Let's continue our worship together.
Thank you. Our scripture reading today comes from Psalm 103, verses 1 through 12. Praise the Lord, my soul, all my inmost being. Praise his holy name. Praise the Lord, my soul. And forget not all his benefits. Who forgives all your sins and heals all your diseases? Who redeems your life from the pit and crowns you with love and compassion? Who satisfies your desires with good things so that your youth is renewed like the eagles. The Lord works righteousness and justice for all the opposed, the oppressed. He made known his ways to Moses, his deeds to the people of Israel. The Lord is compassionate and gracious, slow to anger, abounding in love. He will not always accuse, nor will he harbor his anger forever. He does not treat us as our sins deserve or repay us according to our iniquities. For as high as the heavens are on the earth, so great is his love for those who fear him. As far as the east from the west, so far he has removed our transgressions from it, from us. The word of our God.
Thank you. Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are stilled, when striving cease. My comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. In Christ alone, who took on flesh, righteousness scorned by the ones he came to save. Till on the cross, as Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied. For every sin on him was laid. Here in the death of Christ I live. His body lay, light of the world by darkness slain, then bursting forth in glorious day, up from the grave he rose again. And as he stands in victory, since course has lost its grip on me, blood of Christ. No guilt in life, no fear in death. This is the power of Christ in me. From life's first cry to final breath, Jesus commands my destiny. No power of hell, scheme of man, can ever pluck me from his hand. Till he returns or calls me home, here in the power of Christ I stand.
You may be seated.
Well, the great 19th century Baptist preacher Charles Spurgeon said that every time before he used to preach, he used to walk up to the pulpit and tell himself, I believe in the Holy Spirit. I believe in the Holy Spirit. I'm telling myself that this morning. I just want to lay before you and be honest with you. I feel weak this morning. Tired. But the good news is that the Lord loves to show his strength through our weakness. That being said, let's go before the Lord in prayer this morning and ask that Holy Spirit whom lives in us for his help. Holy Spirit, we believe in you. We know that you are here residing in each and every one of us. We know that your word will not return empty. And so we pray now, Spirit, for your help. Would you take my frailty, my weakness, and would you send out your word with great power and with great glory, to build your church, to exalt Christ. Do that this morning, we pray. In Christ's name, amen. Well, if you have your Bibles, go ahead and turn to Psalm chapter 32. The title for my sermon this morning is The Gospel According to David. As we'll see here, Psalm 32 was written by David. And what he gives us in Psalm 32 is a very clear articulation of the gospel. Yes, the gospel, the good news that Jesus has come, lived a perfect life, and died for our sins so that we could be reconciled to God and experience peace with him now and for all eternity. That is the gospel that David preaches to us in Psalm 32. We don't think of the Old Testament like that very often. We read the Old Testament and we read these laws, we read these obscure things, we read all these psalms. It can be challenging. But make no mistake, the Old Testament preaches the gospel to us. And this psalm here, Psalm 32, is one of the clearest spots where it does so. As I've said, Psalm 32 was written by David. And one other thing to remember is that when David wrote this psalm, and not just this one, but all of the psalms, or all of scripture for that matter, he's not just writing it in a vacuum. Right? There were real life circumstances that led David to sit down and write Psalm 32. It's not as if he just sat down one day and said, okay, the Lord has charged me to write 150 psalms. I've got 31 done. 32's next, so what could I write Psalm 32 about? Forgiveness, that's what I'll write Psalm 32 about. That's a nice theme, let's talk about that. No, there were real-life circumstances that led David to write what he wrote. Now, we don't know exactly what that real-life circumstance was in David's case here, but I think we can speculate, maybe even speculate with some assurance, that he's referring to his sin with Bathsheba that he committed. He does write that about that in Psalm 51, by the way, which is another psalm about forgiveness and repentance, a more famous one even. And he tells us that that is what he wrote after his sin with Bathsheba. Now, he doesn't tell us right in Psalm 32 that that's what he's writing about, but it matches up pretty well. And a lot of the language even is very similar or even the exact same as to what he says in Psalm 51. So if it helps you this morning, you can even think of David writing these words after committing such a terrible and egregious sin that he committed with Bathsheba. All right, that being said, let's look at what he writes. Look at verses 1 and 2 with me. So he starts out, you'll notice the top, he says, of David, a maskil. All right, that is part of verse 1, what he says there. So he tells us it's David, he's writing this, and then he says it's a maskil. Now, we don't know for certain what that word means, but it probably has something to do with the passing on of wisdom, because it comes from that same root word for wisdom. So it could be some kind of word for a song or a poem or something. In fact, if you look at a footnote in your Bible, it probably says a literary or musical term, and it probably has to do with the passing on of wisdom. All right, so this is a psalm or a poem or even a song of wisdom. It is David, from his own experience, passing on or imparting wisdom to God's people. And the wisdom that David would impart to us this morning concerns sin and forgiveness. Look at verses 1 and 2 with me. So he begins, verse 1, blessed is the one whose transgressions are forgiven, whose sins are covered. Blessed is the one whose sin the Lord does not count against them, and in whose spirit is no deceit. All right, notice that verses 1 and 2 both begin with the word blessed. David is announcing a blessing. Now, that word blessed could also just as easily be translated happy. Because say, happy is the one whose transgressions are forgiven. Happy is the one whose sin the Lord does not count against them. Right, so he's announcing the state of blessedness or happiness, this kind of whole life, things are good for me. And he says that the blessed life, the happy life, is the one that has experienced this forgiveness of sin that he talks about. Now, we love to talk about being blessed, and often for good reason. And many of the times we say that we're blessed, those things are right and good and true. And there is so much more that we could say from the scriptures about being blessed and what the blessed life is. But in this particular instance, David's emphasis is that the blessed person is the person who has experienced the forgiveness of sin. Not the person who's rich. Not the person who's healthy. Not the person for whom life is going really well. But the person who has experienced the forgiveness of sin. And the picture he gives us in these two verses is a picture of total forgiveness, of complete forgiveness. Nothing is left behind. So look at verses 1 and 2. Notice, if you're reading the NIV, you may not see it, but he uses three different words for sin. So he said, verse 1, blessed is the one whose transgressions are forgiven. That's the word for sin. Then he says, whose sins are covered. And then in verse 2, blessed is the one whose sin the Lord does not count against him. Now, he uses sins twice in the NIV, but there's actually a different word for sin. So if you have a different translation of the Bible, it will say transgressions and sins and iniquities. And now, we could get really technical here. We could dissect those three different words and look at the nuances between them. What does sin mean? What does transgression mean? And what does iniquity mean? We could do that, but we don't have time or maybe even the energy or maybe even the intellect here today to do it. We'll leave that to smarter people. But what we know for sure is that by using these three different words for sin, David is addressing sin in its totality. So there is no category or no level of sin that what he's about to say doesn't apply to. And this is good news for us. This is good news for us because if David paints a complete picture of human sinfulness, then he paints an equally complete picture of God's forgiveness of our sin. All right, so keep looking at verses 1 and 2. Notice that he doesn't only use three different words for sin, he also uses three different words to describe God's forgiveness. So verse 1 again, blessed is the one whose transgressions are forgiven. Now that word forgiven really has the sense of our sin being carried away or borne away. It's the same word used to describe what the scapegoat does in Leviticus 16 on the Day of Atonement. So if you're familiar with your Bibles in the book of Leviticus, Moses is giving Israel their law, and God tells them that they are to have a Day of Atonement where once a year the people of Israel will gather together. They will bring a goat. The high priest will come, and he will confess the sins of Israel over the goat. He will put his hands on the goat's head and confess the sins of Israel over the goat. And then they would send the goat away into the wilderness to die. When Leviticus 16 describes that process of that goat, it carries away the sins of Israel. It's bearing them away into the wilderness to die. And as it dies, Israel's sin dies with it. That's the image that we get in Leviticus 16. David uses that same word to describe God forgiving our sins here. Our sins are forgiven. They are carried away just as the scapegoat carries away our sin into the wilderness and dies. Right, he goes on in verse 1. to say whose sins are covered. Now, this one's more self-explanatory. It talks about our sin being covered. He's talking about covering, concealing, like a blemish or an imperfection that we have, and we cover it up somehow or some way. So God carries our sin away from us, and he covers our sin. But that's not all. Look at verse 2. David saves the strongest word to describe God's forgiveness for verse 2 when he says, "The Lord does not count sin against us." All right, this word emphasizes that word count. He doesn't count sin. It's a verb of thinking. God does not think of our sin as counting against us. Almost think of an umpire in baseball. A player strikes out, and instead of saying, "Three strikes, you're out," the umpire says, "I'm not going to count those strikes against you." That would be good news for some of us who played baseball, wouldn't it? But this word emphasizes that forgiveness from our sins is utterly a gift of God's grace. And the reason it emphasizes that this is a gift of God's grace is because it involves God assigning a status to us that we don't actually possess. So here's what I mean. Let's think about this. I'm a sinner. You're a sinner. Everybody who's ever lived is a sinner. That is a status that we have. That is what is true of us. It is what defines us in terms of our relationship to God. We are sinners because of what we do, actual committing of evil deeds, the speaking of sinful words. We are sinners by our very nature as well. We do sinful things. We think sinful thoughts. We have sinful motives, even when we do the right thing. Our hearts are drawn to the sinful things. We love the wrong things. We don't love God with all our hearts. We don't love our neighbors as ourselves. We are all sinners, and that is the status that rules over our lives. That is what defines us. Until, that is, God, in his sheer mercy and grace, assigns us a new status. And that status is not a sinner. God assigns us a status of non-sinner. He does not count our sin against us. He no longer thinks of us as sinners, but thinks of us as not sinners. This is what David says God does with human sin. He carries away our sin. He covers our sin. And then he assigns us a new status of not sinner, despite the fact that we are, in fact, sinners. And so the completeness of God's forgiveness here wipes away the completeness of our sin. Brothers and sisters, this is good news. And before we go any further in Psalm 32, we need to answer a question. And that question is this: how can God do this? Does he merely wave a magic wand and forgive us all our sins? Does he just kind of decide on his own to give us a kind of wink-wink and sweep it under the rug? Or to turn a blind eye? Sometimes I have small children, I've done this with my kids, probably not the best parenting tactic, but I've done it. I didn't see it, even though I did. I'm not going to deal with it now. Is that what God does with us? This is probably how the culture at large thinks that God deals with us. Our culture loves to talk about how God is, he is love. He's a God who forgives. And they use that as an excuse to get away with sin. God will forgive, it's okay. But let return to that baseball analogy. Think if you're playing against a team, you're the pitcher, you strike the batter out, and then the umpire says, "Well, I'm not going to count those strikes against you. I'm going to assign you a new status. Yeah, you're still batting. You're not out. If you're the pitcher, what's your thought right away? That's not fair. That's not right. That's unjust. I struck him out. He's out. And that would be unjust. That would be unfair. Think of a judge in one of our courts. Imagine a person undergoes a trial and is found guilty beyond a shadow of a doubt of some sin or some breaking of the law. And the time comes for the judge to issue the sentence. And the judge said, yeah, you screwed up. I know what you did. You committed this crime, no doubt about it. But I love you. So I'm just going to decide to let it slide this time. You're free to go. Now, that wouldn't be loving at all. That would be the height of injustice. It would be unfair. In the same way, God is a just judge. He is holy and righteous. He cannot merely let sin slide. He must issue a fair and just judgment. He must condemn our sin. And the thing that is fair and just is for us to be condemned to an eternity of suffering in hell. But Psalm 32 says God forgives our sin. He covers it. He carries it away from us. He does not count it against us. How can God do this? And the answer is a person. And his name is Jesus. Just like the scapegoat of Leviticus 16 on the Day of Atonement bore away the sins of Israel, so does Christ bear our sin away. Just as that goat bore the wrath, bore the punishment for the sin that was due, that was just, that was right, so does Jesus bear away our sin. I could point to any number of passages throughout the Bible to find the answer and to support that. But there's one verse that says it more clearly and more succinctly than any other verse in the Bible. That is 2 Corinthians 5:21, where Paul writes, God made him who had no sin to be sin for us, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. Or how about 1 Peter 2:24? He himself, that is Jesus, bore, that's the same word again, he bore or he carried our sins in his body on the cross so that we might die to sins and live for righteousness. So how does God carry away our sins? Jesus carries them to the cross with him. How does God cover our sins? Like he says in Psalm 32, the blood of Jesus shed on the cross covers our sins. How does God assign to us the status of a non-sinner when we are in fact sinners? Jesus was a non-sinner, the only righteous person who ever lived, and his status of non-sinner, of righteous one, becomes ours by faith in him. The totality of our sinfulness can be totally forgiven because Jesus has paid for every single one of those sins. Our sins, they are many. His mercy is more. Praise the Lord. And the good news of the gospel is that all of this forgiveness, this new status, eternal life, every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places is ours simply by repenting of our sin and turning to Jesus in faith. That may not be clear right in the text in Psalm 32. But Psalm 32, 1 and 2, where it talks about blessed is the one whose sins are forgiven. In one of the most important chapters in the whole Bible, Romans chapter 4, Paul takes those two verses and he applies them to what Jesus has done. And he proves that David was, in fact, preaching the gospel to us hundreds of years before Christ came. He says, we have been justified, that is declared righteous by faith and faith alone in Jesus. And so we experience this forever. forgiveness. Brothers and sisters, this is the good news of the gospel. But David knows something else too. David knows that as good of news as this is, I mean, it's almost too good to be true, that the totality of our sin would be taken care of by God and forgiven. David knows that as good of news as this is, we will be slow to accept it. And that's why he goes on to warn us in verses 3 and 4. Look at those verses with me. He says, "When I kept silent, my bones wasted away through my groaning all day long. For day and night your hand was heavy on me. My strength was sapped as in the heat of summer." See, David warns us in these verses because he knows firsthand how deceitful and how destructive sin is. Apparently, David did not immediately confess his sin and repent. So if he is, in fact, referring to his sin with Bathsheba here, you think he about that passage where that's described, 2 Samuel 11, I believe, he doesn't come out and repent right away, but only after a faithful brother and friend, Nathan, confronts him of his sin. Does he then confess that sin and repent of it? See, rather than immediately confessing his sin and allowing it to be covered by Jesus, David decided to try to cover up his sin himself. And you see that in the account by doing all the things he does to have Bathsheba's husband killed and to try to cover his sin. Rather than humbly making his sin known and trusting in the righteousness of Jesus, he chose to trust in his own self-righteousness. He chose to try to deceive the rest of Israel and all the people he knew by not allowing his sin to be known. And this is what sin does to us. This is how sin deceives us. It convinces us that we're really not that bad. I sin, but it's really not that bad, so I don't need to confess it. Or sin convinces us that it's not really hurting us or anybody else. Right? It's just a white lie. Didn't hurt me. Didn't hurt anybody else. Looking at pornography doesn't hurt me or anybody else. Or we know it's sin and we know it's evil, yet we convince ourselves that we can just kind of cover it up and keep it hidden, and we can kind of manage it, keep it from becoming too bad or from springing up to where it becomes noticeable. We try to treat sin like it's a benign tumor. It's there, we know it's there, but we just kind of ignore it, thinking it's not really hurting us. We can just kind of live with it. But David makes it clear in this text, sin cannot be merely managed. It cannot be covered up without consequence. It is always a malignant tumor. Look what David says happened to him when he covered his sin. He says, "My bones wasted away through my groaning all day long. Day and night your hand was heavy on me. My strength was sapped as in the heat of summer." If you have experienced ongoing sin in your life, or if you're experiencing that right now, you know what David is talking about. You know that feeling of your bones wasting away under the weight of your sin. You know the weight of God's hand of conviction pressing down on you, of your strength being sapped as on a hot summer day. Sin is always a cancer that spreads throughout our lives and even into the lives of others. It is always destructive. It is always harmful to ourselves and to those around us. Like I said, I've been there. As a young Christian for years, still struggling with sin, harboring secret sin in my life, not wanting to confess it and expose it, but trying to keep it covered up, trusting in my own self-righteousness rather than that of Jesus, all the while wondering why there was so little joy in my life, wondering why my prayer life was so weak, wondering why my time reading the Bible was so dull, so ineffective. Showing up to church every week and going through the motions, wondering why my heart wasn't stirred to rejoice and sing. It was like my bones were wasting away and my strength was sapped because of the sin I was harboring in my life. And perhaps you're there right now. Even this morning, harboring some secret sin in your life, yet wondering why your spiritual strength feels sapped all the time. And if that is you, there is good news for you. Look at verse 5. David goes on in his testimony. He says he didn't confess his sin for a while. He covered it up himself. And then verse 5, I acknowledged my sin to you, and I did not cover up my iniquity. I said, I will confess my transgressions to the Lord. And look at that last part. And you forgave the guilt of my sin. The only way we can experience the total forgiveness David is talking about in verses 1 and 2 is by confessing it. The only way to be freed from sin is to do the exact opposite of what we are inclined to do. We're inclined to cover our sin up. But the irony of that is that when we cover our sin up, it is not actually covered. The only way sin is actually covered is when God covers it by the blood of Christ. Now, there is much more to be said from Psalm 32. That was the first 5 verses, and there are 11 total in the psalm. For the sake of time, we won't have time to get through the rest of Psalm 32 today. So let me close with this. Let me try to bring this together for us here this morning and give you some points of application to walk away with. The first thing I want to say is this. There are 2 different groups of people I'm addressing this morning, and God's word is addressing, and it's important that we distinguish between the two so as to avoid confusion. The first group I want to address is the non-Christian. Because if you are a Christian or if you are not a Christian, that will affect how you should read and understand Psalm 32 for your life. Let me show you what I mean. If you are not a Christian, have you put aside your sin and trusted in Jesus alone for your salvation? Have you done that? Have you come to recognize that you yourself are a sinner? This is where God does something in us. This is how God converts us. Like many people, I grew up in a church knowing the facts, knowing I'm a sinner, we're all sinners. But here's what I didn't come to know or come to a realization of. I could state that I knew I was a sinner, but that was just a fact that I was giving mental assent to. It was just something I agreed with. I had not actually come to know myself as a sinner. And so I'm asking you, have you come to recognize that you yourself are a sinner? Not just agreeing with the fact, but have you come to know experientially, like in your actual life, in your experience, that you are a sinner? Have you felt the weight of sin that David is talking about in verses 3 and 4? Have you felt your bones wasting away under the weight of your sin? Because until you come to truly know yourself as a sinner, you cannot and you will not experience the true forgiveness of knowing Christ. And so to you who are a non-Christian this morning, I would say to you, see yourself as a sinner. Feel the weight of your sin and then turn to Christ in faith. And experience the totality of forgiveness that he offers through his shed blood on the cross. Turn to Jesus and see your sins carried away. Turn to Jesus and see your sins covered by his blood. Turn to Jesus and receive the new status of righteous one assigned to you. And then follow Jesus with your life. That's the first group I would address this morning. To the non-Christian, you must read this and you must hear this as a call to turn from your sin and believe in Jesus. Now, to the Christian, to those of you who are saying, yeah, I've done that. However old you were, I've trusted in Christ for my salvation. I've been saved. How ought we to read this verse or this passage? The first thing I would say to you is this. Rest in the finished work of Christ. He has done it all. He has lived the righteous life. He has paid for your every sin. He has gone to the cross and borne it away. And all that forgiveness is yours in Christ. And so if you are a Christian, feeling the burden of guilt, wondering, am I even saved because I still do sinful things? I'm not perfect yet. Brother and sister, will you rest in the finished work of Christ? Will you see that in Jesus, your transgressions have been forgiven once and for all? That in Jesus, your iniquity has been covered, and that in Jesus, your sin has not been counted to you? You say, yeah, but you don't know what I've done. Even the sins I've committed while being a Christian. Maybe even in the past year or the past month. Maybe even last night. Guilt-ridden Christians, be comforted. Know that your sin in its totality has been dealt with by Christ on the cross. And so rest, be assured of your salvation today, for Christ has accomplished it. The second thing I would say to you Christians is this, and that Psalm 32 says to us is this. Okay, I've trusted in Christ for my salvation. I've experienced this forgiveness, but I still sin in my life. I still struggle with sin. And what I would say to you this morning is this, and what Psalm 32 would say to you is this. Yes, you've been given a status of righteous one, and that is irrevocable. It cannot be taken away. That is a once and for all thing. But yet we still struggle with sin. So yes, having been saved by grace, we must still confess ongoing sin in our lives, just as David did in this text. But too often what we do, even after we become Christians, is we hide our sin, just like David talks about in this passage. Now, I haven't been here at Haven Heights long enough to see it firsthand, but I've been born and raised in Northwest Ohio. Right here in Wauseon, in fact. And I know the way it is in Northwest Ohio. We can be a stubborn people. We like to act like everything is okay. We don't like to admit we have problems, let alone even talk about those problems with other people. And so this happens when we struggle with sin, whether it's anger or lust or jealousy or gossip or whatever sin you can think of. We struggle with it and we feel its weight and its burden, and yet we keep it to ourselves. We cover it and we end up living in it, stuck in it, with our strength sapped for weeks or months or even years. All the while, to everyone around us, we look great. We show up to church, we give, we sing, we serve the church. People ask how we are. We say, I'm good, how about you? And then we make small talk about sports or the weather or what have you. Oh, but brothers and sisters, if we have trusted in Christ for our salvation, we don't need to hide our sin anymore. The gospel has outed us all as sinners. If you're here, a member of the church, trusting in Christ, you've been outed. You are a sinner. And that sin has been dealt with by Christ on the cross, so that now we can be free to confess our ongoing sin. We know that there is therefore no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus, so we don't need to hide it. We don't need to fear condemnation from God or from our brothers and sisters in Christ. We only harm ourselves when we hide it. Sin thrives in the darkness, and as long as we keep it in the dark, it will continue to thrive. Your sin will only truly die when you expose it to the lie by confessing it to God, yes. 1 John 1:9 says that if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. But James 5:16 also tells us that we ought to confess our sins to one another, that we may be healed. And so my encouragement to us as brothers and sisters in Christ here this morning, I include myself in this because I'm from Northwest Ohio, and I do the same thing. Let us confess our sins to one another that we may be healed. Let us swallow our pride and our stubbornness, and let us move beyond trite small talk. That's fine, we can do that, but let us confess our sins to one another. And brothers and sisters, when we do this, there is great joy to be experienced. And we see that in Psalm 32. We'll close with this. After verses 1 through 5, when David says he went from hiding his sin to confessing it, to experiencing the forgiveness of God, look at verse 7. He says, to God, you are my hiding place. You will protect me from trouble and surround me with songs of deliverance. And then he ends in verse 11. This is the result of exposing our sin, both to God and to one another, and experiencing the total forgiveness that is offered in Christ. Rejoice in the Lord and be glad, you righteous. Sing, all you who are upright in heart. That is the joy we experience when our sin is confessed and exposed and laid bare before the Lord and before one another, and when we experience the grace of Christ and his forgiveness. And so, brother and sister in Christ, let us confess our sins to one another this morning. Let us experience the forgiveness offered in Christ, and let us rejoice in it. And let's do so as we sing this closing song. Let's pray. Father, we pray that your Spirit would do the work of exposing sin in our lives now. And we pray that as we do so, that you would turn our eyes and our hearts to Jesus on the cross. Help us to see his finished work. Help us to see the totality of our sin covered by the totality of your grace. Oh, and Lord, may you fill our hearts with rejoicing this morning Let us sing of the great salvation you have won for us at the cross. We pray this in Christ's name. Amen.
Please stand.
And can it be that I should gain an interest in the Savior's blood? Died he for me who caused his pain, for me who him to death?
Romans 8:1. Therefore, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Because through Christ Jesus, the law of the Spirit who gives life has set you free from the law of sin and death. For what the law was powerless to do, because it was weakened by the flesh, God did by sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh to be a sin offering. And so he condemned sin in the flesh. Brothers and sisters, there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ. Let us go and live and rest in that freedom this week. And let that free us to walk faithfully with Christ and with one another. You are dismissed.